Why did Turkey shoot down a Russian warplane? It's one of the most serious incidents between a NATO member and Russia in 50 years. Both countries have contradicting accounts of what happened. What does it tell us about the power struggle in Syria? This is Inside Story. Hello, a warm welcome to the program. I'm Hazem Seeker. It's just the kind of incident that many have warned could happen over the busy skies of Syria, with Russian and NATO combat planes operating in the same area. But the shooting down of a Russian jet by Turkey seems to be about more than a border incursion, with both countries supporting different factions in Syria's war. Russia's foreign minister believes it was a planned provocation. He says they'll seriously reconsider relations with Turkey. President Recep Tayyip Erdogan has defended the Turkish military action, but says he doesn't want to escalate the situation. So what exactly are the two countries saying happened on Tuesday? Well, Turkey says two Russian aircraft flew into Turkish airspace for 17 seconds, and the pilots of the downed jet were warned to change direction 10 times. Russian leaders insist the jet never crossed into Turkish airspace. President Vladimir Putin says it was 1 kilometer inside Syria when it was attacked. As we've been saying, the Turkish action doesn't appear to have been motivated by just a border incursion. Turkey is angry at Russian airstrikes targeting Syrian rebel groups. President Erdogan has been speaking out in support of Turkmen in Syria. They're ethnic Turks who have been living in the country for around 1,000 years. Most of them live in this northern mountainous region of Syria where the Russian jet went down. Russia's been attacking the Turkmen, who were some of the first to rise up and fight Syria's President Bashar al-Assad when the civil war began. Other Syrian opposition groups have also been hit by Russian airstrikes over the past 2 months. On Monday, the day before the jet was down, Turkey called for a United Nations Security Council meeting to discuss those attacks. Prime Minister Ahmet Davutoğlu warned Russia that the Turkish government would take all necessary steps to protect the Turkmen people in Syria. So lots to discuss on today's Inside Story. Let's bring in our guests then in Moscow. We're joined by Vladimir Sotnikov. He is a strategic analyst at the Institute of Oriental Studies at the Russian Academy of Sciences, specializing in Russian foreign and defense policy. In Istanbul, Soner Çaptay, who is the director of the Turkish Research Program with the Washington Institute. And joining us from Washington, D.C., Kurt Volker. He is a former U.S. ambassador to NATO and now the executive director of the McCain Institute for International Leadership. Welcome to you all. Now, Soner Çaptay, if I could start with you. We know what the Turkish government's explanation for this is that as far as they're concerned, the Russian plane violated Turkish airspace and they had no choice but to act. But from the Turkish point of view, what happens next here? Is there a risk of this conflict escalating further as a result of Turkey's actions?
Russian planes have been violating Turkish airspace for a while now, ever since Russia deployed troops and planes into Syria. So I guess Turkey's reaction was timed because there was a lot of pressure building inside the country that the government do something to help the Turkmens. Lately, the Russian Air Force had been bombing areas of northern Syria populated by Turkmens. Turkmens are an ethnic group related to Anatolian Turks across the border, and the government was coming under immense amount of pressure. But I think this was also the government's way of telling the Russians that it was not supportive of Russia's policy of helping the Assad regime and cracking down on the rebel positions, including some held by the Turkmens. I think that the Russians will react to this. Even though this escalation may not end up going into a military conflict, and I certainly hope it does not, we may see a de-escalation. I think that Moscow will make a note of this. Now, Turkey has humiliated Moscow's efforts to rise as a regional power, both in Syria, but also in the broader Middle East. And I think if not this time, in the near future, you're going to see that Russia will retaliate. And my guess is that Russian retaliation will be either commercial wars against Turkish exports to Russia, and more significantly, a boost to the Assad government, as well as more frequent bombing of the rebel positions so that Turkey-backed rebels are squeezed out in northern Syria. So this could actually lead, ironically, to an escalation of the conflict in northern Syria and having the unintended consequence, perhaps, from the Turkish side.
Vladimir Sotnikov, is that how you see it in terms of the way Russia might react to this?
Well, actually, it's already clearly that Russia will... Russia has already reacted swiftly and rapidly, you know, and I think that the most probable reaction will be, just like my colleague from Turkey said, this is a commercial-wise, commercial reaction, some project, as the Russian Prime Minister Medvedev said, that will be suspended, and I think they could be suspended, that is for sure. And probably the whole fabric of the relationship between Russia and Turkey could be reconsidered again. So, but first of all, this is businesses. This is travel by Russian citizens to Turkey, because some flights, some touristic flights were suspended. So this is first of all economic reactions. And regarding the escalation or de-escalation, the possible military conflict without anything substantive. Regarding possible military conflict between Turkey and Russia, I completely exclude anything like that.
Kurt Volker, what's your take on this? And as we've been saying, there've been completely contradictory accounts about what exactly happened here. What do you think happened, and what consequences do you think it's going to have?
I think that Russian pilots were being careless, clipping Turkish airspace with some regularity just because it's easier to conduct the bombing runs that they were doing by doing so. And they didn't anticipate that Turkey would really shoot down a Russian aircraft. But Turkey did. I think Turkey appropriately made several complaints, several warnings, called in the Russian ambassador in Ankara, warned this particular plane, and then did fire on it in order to make a point that you can't use Turkish airspace like that, and a way of showing some strength. But as both of the analysts have said, I agree with them, neither country wants to go to war with each other over this. This is not a Turkey-Russia conflict. This is about Syria. And I think Russia will be a little bit more careful about where its pilots fly. I think that both sides want to avoid any further incidents. And I think what's going to happen now is both sides, but I would say particularly Russia in this instance, will be trying to use the incident as a way to build more support for its position on Syria, which is to say, making the argument that the best case for getting rid of ISIS is to work with Russia, work with Iran, support the Assad regime, something that Turkey has not supported. And I think that it's going to be aiming particularly at Europe in getting support for that. And we've already seen some sympathetic signals from Germany and France. When they see a Russian plane shot down, they don't want to see that kind of rampant and uncontrolled escalation of a conflict. And their instinct is to say, well, maybe we should be working together with Russia, which has forces in the fight already in Syria.
All right, let's put that then to Soner in Istanbul. Do you think this could be seen as kind of a wake-up call to Turkey, that they should make more of more moves towards getting closer to being on the same page with Russia in terms of going after ISIL?
I think that Turkey will probably never be on the same page with Russia in the Syrian war. The two countries have opposing views and objectives. Turkey's main goal is to oust the Assad regime, and Russia's main goal is to keep him alive. And so that really puts them at odds, regardless of what they do on ISIS. I think that Turkey, France, United States, Russia all maybe share the objective of going after ISIS, but at various varying levels. The United States is more serious. France has become more serious. I don't think Russia is that serious about going after ISIS. After all, it has been mainly targeting rebel positions, non-ISIS rebel positions, that is, positions of rebels who are opposing the Assad government. And I think that's actually having an effect of strengthening ISIS, because Russian airstrikes have been debilitating the political center in Syria. And if they continue and succeed, The Syrian civil war, which has so far been a non-binary conflict involving many sides, ISIS and moderate rebels and Assad regime and Kurds and Al-Qaeda, I think the Russian attacks will probably cast this maybe into a binary war, debilitating the middle and casting this as a binary war of ISIS versus Assad. And that's definitely not where Turkey wants to go, because Turkey sees both ISIS and Assad as major threats. So I think while this issue, this crisis may not blow up any further, and I certainly hope that it does not, Turkish-Russian views on Syria remain largely irreconcilable. And I think that's primarily because Turkey's policy of ousting Assad regime has been opposed by Russia for a very long time, and now Russia is doing this militarily. Of course, watching this from Istanbul reminds me of historic animosity between the Ottomans and the Russians. The Ottoman and Russian empires fought 17 campaigns from the 15th century up until the end of the Russian Empire in 1917. The Russians started all of them, and the Ottomans lost all of them. That's why what's happening in Syria is significant. I hope that we don't see a repeat of history here, most certainly.
Yeah, let's come back to Vladimir on this. There is a view that Russia has behaved somewhat recklessly here and is playing a dangerous game here in trying to see the limits of its power in Syria and how it's able to operate over the skies of Syria. What do you say to that?
Well, I don't think, actually, and I do not agree with my previous esteemed colleague, with a colleague from Turkey, that Russia is playing any games, and that Russia is historically was on sharp ends with Turkey. Yeah, well, there were some intense moments, and there was a Turkish-Russian rivalry, if we are taking the ancient history and the historical relationship between Turkey and Russia. But in this case, with the Russian plane, actually, and I do not agree with my American colleague, actually, that the pilots were just careless. I mean, the evidence which I witnessed very, very much intensively on the TV, and the TV footage itself by Turkish TV shows that the plane was already in for several seconds in the Syrian space, and it was shot down from the tail. But that's not actually the topic of your question. I would like to say that Russia is not actually playing any backdoor games. The real aim of Moscow actually is just to it was actually before this tragic incident with the Russian military plane to foster the big coalition, big anti-ISIS coalition, and I am just very much in doubt that this coalition could be ever fostered again. And the main thing is just to fight against the ISIS and not to bomb the Turkmen, or just to keep, as they say, the Bashar Assad government alive for indefinite time.
But hasn't that been the goal of Russia from the beginning of its involvement in Syria? Although they haven't said it outright, that they are essentially there to protect the Assad regime, aren't they?
Well, actually, Russia is not was not hiding away that Russia is supporting Bashar Assad government, actually. But at the same time, Russia repeatedly said that it is not sticking to Bashar Assad regime or Bashar Assad government, whatever you call it, actually. And if there will be a peaceful settlement, fine, that there will be a transition period, probably there will be another figure who will be just presiding over Syrian people, actually. So the only thing I think that Russia wants, actually, this is the possible peaceful settlement of this long-standing and very serious conflict, which could lead to unpredictable circumstances in the region.
I want to talk a little bit about the Turkmen, which is the group of people on this border area between Syria and Turkey. Soner Chaptar, you mentioned them earlier. What role do the Turkmen play here, and help us understand their role in this border, in this region, and the larger conflict in Syria? Is this about protecting them rather than just the Russians violating Turkish airspace?
The Turkmen are a part of Syria. Syria's pre-war population was just over 20 million people. The Turkmen are over 250,000 strong, so they were really almost just over 1% of Syria's pre-war population. That mix has changed because of significant amount of refugees leaving the country. But nevertheless, this was a small group in that country, but concentrated in pockets of Syrian territory along the Turkish border in two areas, one of which is this region where the Russian plane was downed by Turkey after it violated Turkish airspace. So it lies right across from Turkish territory. Although I'm based in the US, I've been in Turkey for meetings the last few days, and I've been seeing in the media public's outrage at the Russian bombing of Turkmen civilians and villages and the suffering. And people were talking about a Turkmen exodus of tens of thousands of people into Turkey. So clearly there is a sympathy here by the public to their ethnic kin. The Turkmens in Iraq and Syria are related to the Turks in Turkey in the same way Highland Scots are related to Scots. So they really are part of the nation. Perhaps they are more of tribal origins. So Turks see them as their close ethnic and political kin. And the government definitely felt pressured to go in and to do something as the plight of Turkmens were being highlighted in the media. But as I said, I think that's only one of the motives of Ankara. The other motive being that Turkey was upset for a long time by Russia's violation of its airspace, that those violations had been going on for a while. And Turkey, I think, finally decided to do something about this. But maybe they miscalculated the Russian reaction, because I think Russia's reaction, of which we have seen only part, it's probably going to come even more significant in the coming days. As my Russian colleague said, this is probably going to be some sort of a trade war. Russia has already banned the import of meats and poultry from Turkey, as Russia buys significant amount of foodstuffs from Turkey, dairy, meat, fruits and vegetables. And I can just see how, as it has done in the past, Moscow, when it had troubles with its neighbors, it has used trade as an instrument of foreign policy. It banned, for example, the import of wines from Georgia and Moldova when it had conflicts with those countries, suggesting that it was protecting its consumers, but really acting with a political intent. So it could do the same with Turkey, banning the import of certain foodstuffs. And that put pressure on the government in Ankara. The government, of course, is supported by significant business interests, and some of these might be upset by the loss of their markets in Russia.
I want to get Vladimir's point of view on that in just a moment, but first we'll just turn back to Kurt Volker. And Kurt, I want to ask you how you think this is going to affect the broader relationship between Russia and the West. And the reason I ask that is because coming after the attacks in France and the shooting down of the Russian airliner, it did seem as if things were moving in the direction of closer ties between Russia and the West in terms of finding some common ground in the fight against ISIL. Do you think this incident now has set that back?
No, I think it has actually probably reinforced that trend. We've seen that West Europeans, particularly France and Germany again, are uncomfortable when they're at odds with Russia all the time. They have imposed sanctions over the war in Ukraine. But they've been hoping that they can find ways to work together with Russia. There's always a desire to try to reach out a hand. After the attacks in Paris, I think the French very clearly came around to the view that between Assad and ISIS, ISIS is the bigger threat, ISIS is the priority, and maybe that they should be working together with Russia on going after ISIS, even though Russia is not really doing that at the moment. But maybe they should be working together with Russia and maybe more tolerant of the fact that if you're going to go after ISIS, maybe you need Assad in power in order to have a government. So they've changed their views considerably. We heard similar words come out of Foreign Minister Steinmeier in Germany yesterday, where he was also saying that maybe it's time to work more closely with Russia and even raising the prospect of sanctions relief. So I think we're seeing actually a closer convergence between Europe and Russia at the moment.
Vladimir, have we seen perhaps the limits of Russia's power? Will they think twice, for example, about entering Turkey's airspace next time? I know there is a dispute over whether they actually did that this time, but will they be kind of looking at this again now the next time they carry out operations like this?
Well, I think that what actually should be done, to be honest, actually, that each stakeholder, which is somehow like Turkey, like other stakeholders, which are having significant interest in this volatile area, I mean, very, very, very sensitive area, like Syria, like novel Syria, should stick to this agreement which was reached between Russia and the United States about the prevention of any incidents in the airspace, because there are a lot of aircraft, military aircraft, flying over in the skies above Syria. So that's one thing. Another thing, I hope that after all this war of nerves and all war of diplomacy, actually, between which is now between Russia and Turkey, and all these words of which were said diplomatically and undiplomatically to each other. I mean, finally, at the end of the day, the main purpose of fighting against ISIS militants and against international terrorism would take over. And I hope that this bigger coalition will be somehow fostered, including all the major stakeholders, including Iran, including other stakeholders, and with the prevention of any incidents, so and the countries could concentrate, the stakeholders could concentrate on the main thing, on the main goal, to fight international terrorism. Otherwise, we can witness the terrorist acts like it was in Paris almost 2 weeks ago, wherever they would have a reach, in Moscow, in Ankara, even in the U.S. soil.
So now, how do you respond to that?
Look, I think Ankara found it comforting that NATO alliance stood behind Turkey, and U.S. President Obama has said that Turkey has the right to defend its territory. All this is welcome news. But at the same time, I also think that Turkey will find it difficult to get NATO members from Europe, for example, to align behind its position on Syria, especially because Russian foreign policy will now be taking advantage of splits between the United States and Europe, and also Eastern and Western Europe on certain foreign policy issues, as they have done so masterfully on Ukraine. I think they'll also do on Syria. For instance, France was probably the country whose position on Syria was closest to Turkey until the ISIS attacks in Paris. Now the French position is closer to other countries. It actually wants to fight ISIS more than fighting the Assad regime. So France is no more an ally of Ankara within NATO. And I think France, which is carrying out joint airstrikes with Russia, is of course not one to go after break that alliance with Russia. So I think Russia now has some allies in European countries, as Kurt said, France being one of them. And it will be difficult for Turkey to rally its European allies behind this position, although it has the support of the United States when it comes to Russia and Syria.
Kurt Volker, how do you see this playing out then? I mean, we mentioned at the top there how crowded the skies are over Syria. Lots of competing actors in this with competing agendas. Is there a risk that this could escalate further and we could see more incidents like this?
Well, I think we have all very professional militaries, whether it's the United States or France or Turkey or Russia, and they are quite capable of communicating with one another and setting lines, saying we operate here and notifying each other, and people can deconflict. So I think there'll be every effort made to deconflict in that way and avoid coming into contact. So that's the first thing I would say. The second is I do not expect the United States to do much more than it's already doing. I'm sorry to say that. I wish we were doing more, but I just don't see that coming. And so when you look at how other countries read the situation, they're going to see a reticent United States. They're going to be wanting to do more to go after ISIS. That's what President Hollande was trying to do with President Obama yesterday,
right,
was pull him more into this.
Just briefly to pick up on what
Russia's
you were saying, you want to see
position.
The U.S. doing more. What specifically would you want to see them doing, just briefly?
Oh, I would love to see the U.S. Adopt a strategy of the destruction of ISIS as quickly as possible. And that would involve much more significant airstrikes, possibly more forces on the ground, coordinating with others in the region more assertively, having their forces on the ground as well, creating a safe haven inside Syria and creating a no-fly zone over that space in Syria, which could be done by coordinating with others there in order to stem the refugee flows, to try to create a balance of forces in the fighting and set the conditions for more effective negotiations than we have right now.
All right. And on that, we're going to have to leave it. Thank you to all of my guests, Vladimir Sotnikov, Sonia Shabtai, and Kurt Volker. Thanks very much for being on Inside Story.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And that's it for another edition of the show. Thank you for watching. As always, you can leave your comments on the program's page of our website, aljazeera.com. And you can post your views to us. We're on Facebook. It's facebook.com/AJ Inside Story. And we're also on Twitter. Just tweet us at AJ Inside Story is the address. Thanks for watching. For me, Hazem Seeker, and all the team here. Bye for now.